Thousands use the cognitive model implied by case-based reasoning to guide the design of science curriculum for middle school, and the resulting approach, learning by design, contributed to the publishing of a three-year middle school science curriculum, project-based inquiry science. More recently, she's been focusing on the development of disposition towards carrying out the practices of scientists, something a lot of our projects are engaged in, and identity as a scientific resource, scientific identity. She's interested in how people learn and how to use technology and good pedagogy to help them deepen their understanding. The title of the talk today is The Promise of Learning Technologies for Science Education, A View from the Learning Sciences. And I'm really excited to learn about all the insight you've gained as the former program director at NSF for and within the Cyberlearning and Future Learning Technologies program. And she's gonna give us a insight into what's known about how people learn to help audiences and to help us imagine a future for learning technologies that focuses on
the period of my life when I was just starting to move into taking what I knew from computer science and artificial intelligence and moving it into education. And I know Alyssa from the latest, you know, time of my life, which was at the National Science Foundation and learning about the nifty telescope stuff these guys are doing. So tell me more. Are you all education oriented? Or do you?
Most of the people in the room are affiliated with the science education department under Phil. Mm-hmm. And then a few people in the room are scientists and researchers interested in education.
Okay.
Here at the observatory.
Okay.
All right.
So I'm not going to tell you a whole lot about how people learn. I have a slide that says some very basic things. But I did want to show you a bunch of things about promises of technology, not just promises of technology. I changed the name as we went along. And should we be connecting me to the stream or something? How's the stream working?
Should we get a projector?
What?
Well, Mary just gonna have to get a projector in case it's just.
Okay. I'm not sure what to do. If I'm supposed to start, if the people who are streaming it are gonna see anything or hear anything. So here's what I want to say. Okay, I'm gonna start. So I have a few claims to make, okay? The first claim is that there are a lot of different ways that technology can be game-changing for science education. So you're gonna flip that up?
Can you get me
an extension cord? Yeah. I'm not used to it.
We'll get you all set up.
No worries. It's too crazy. And what do we do about microphone streaming while you're at that?
That's all.
Okay, but I don't need to put this on?
We're bringing her closer.
Right here?
Does it have to be that far?
Well.
Turn this on and see what the meeting looks like.
Okay.
Should be good.
Is there an extension or should I, should we have Jim's?
So I had this opportunity when I was in, at the National Science Foundation to meet people from all over the country and in fact all over the world who had really nifty technologies that they were using, that they wanted to use for education. A lot of the technologies, the educational technologies that are out there are for teachers to use, and they're about, or you got MOOCs, about broadcasting lectures, so everybody can be bored by it. So a lot of technologies out there are about access. Most of the technologies that are out there are about making things easier for teachers, grading, handing assignments, making assignments. And I have opportunities to talk to, a lot of people about the, to see a lot of the technologies people were building to actually make it easier for learners to learn. Okay.
There you go.
And I learned a tremendous amount from that experience. I loved being at the National Science Foundation, kind of being able to be on top and, watching everything going on around me and giving a ton of advice to people. So Pat knows about the advice giving. Giving a ton of advice to people whose, projects just or technologies just seemed so promising to me. Often there were people who had really promising technologies but didn't really know enough about learning to be able to take full advantage of them for helping people learn. So a lot of times I did matchmaking, or I tried to do matchmaking between people who had technologies and people who knew about learning. I actually failed in doing that for these guys. I hooked them up to somebody who was more traditional about education than what their technology allows, and didn't help them to have the, it thwarted their imaginations instead of helping their imaginations. So I think that was there was one other one where I did that, but mostly I was pretty good at it. Okay, so let me start. So all that was just to say that I learned a tremendous amount. And so I want to share some of what I learned about what technology can do for us, for education, share some of that with you. And I think the first thing I want to do is to make this set of claims, okay? Technology can be game-changing for learners. Not just for science education, but for learners of science, okay? Certainly gives access to tools and resources, and, everybody talks about that. But the other things that, to me, are so exciting about technology for science education are affordances that it has for role play, okay? Role play could mean playing roles as scientists, but it could mean playing roles as other things, and I'm going to show you an example where kids are playing roles as molecules, and they're learning about phases of matter, okay? By playing roles as molecules and acting it out, they're learning about how the bees communicate with each other by acting it out. So it gives it gives affordances for role play. Affordances for experiencing situations, phenomena, and processes that couldn't be experienced otherwise. And of course, that's what the Worldwide Telescope does. But that's kind of a more traditional thing that we think about. We've got simulations and we've got modeling tools, and they've been around for a long time. But I think that there also are much more sophisticated kinds of embedding into situations that can happen with technology. That
can just real, you're going to see, I mean, I like to talk about the joy that scientists have, okay, when they do what they do, okay? But that can really help kids to have that same kind of joy. Computers, technology can also provide support for expression that, for different kinds of expression that it's hard to have otherwise. And I guess my collaborative sketching is one example of that. And you could do collaborative sketching, you know, on a piece of paper too. But there are other things you could, when you do it with a computer, there are other things that can happen. But that, but not just collaborative sketching. Also, something like what you get with Scratch, where you get to actually express process, express how things work. And of course, for collaboration of all kinds. The other claim that I want to make, the second claim I want to make is that if we take full advantage of what technology can do in these realms, okay, then school's not going to be anymore sitting down and listening to a teacher. And neither is it going to be, you know, working on toy problems. Okay? It can be working on the same kinds of things that scientists and other disciplinary people work on, disciplinary experts work on. And my claim is that we can right now develop coherent and sustained curriculum that goes over years, okay, a full year and then years. Right now, that has that kind of project-based, mission-driven, active kind of pedagogy, and that uses technology really well. But of course, it will take resources, will, and imagination. Will and imagination, I think, are harder than resources. But okay. Oh, this is so small. I'm so sorry. Okay. So. Here's what I want to say about what education could look like, even in K-12, okay? You don't have to be able to read this, okay? The way I envision it, classrooms are going to be, they can be, and they will be, places for addressing challenges together. Finding stuff out there in the stars, you know, in the cosmos, could be a classroom activity, right? And doing the reflection and discussion needed for learning from those experiences. Activities will be really varied, as are the activities of disciplinary people, right? And analogous to what scientists really do, lectures will become uncommon. They'll be, when they're there, they'll be short, okay? Reading will be common, but it will come at the times when people need something. Lectures as well will come at the times when people need something, accompanied by scaffolding. Peers will take on collective cognitive responsibilities. That is, classes will work as groups to discover things together, to solve problems together, okay, to design together. Learning will be purposeful, focused on skills and practices, important skills and practices for living a life, for being a scientist, for stewarding the planet, for health and well-being, all of these things that are so important for living a life. It won't all be textbook-driven. Opportunities for promoting learning will be grabbed from the experiences that learners have. Okay, and learning of content and practices will be integrated, are integrated by having learners learn both in the same context, with learning technologies used for the whole variety of roles that you guys use them for and more, okay? And students will experience in the classroom the joy of doing scientists as scientists do it, and yes, they will experience some of the drudgery as well, but like scientists, like disciplinary people, they'll know why that drudgery is so important and why they're doing it, okay? And the highs will, you know, be on their side. So that sounds familiar, right? I mean, it's what you do every day. Or what you did every day, if you're working on education now, maybe it's still what you do every day. Okay, but it's what scientists do every day. And in fact, it's really very much a PhD student kind of experience, right? We know how to do it for PhD students. So I want to help you imagine what it could be like in K to 12 classrooms. I've got a fourth grade example, a 10th grade example, and a seventh grade example. The 10th grade example I realized this morning is actually not science, it's history. But it's history, it's inquiry history, so it's the same, okay? So here you go. You're in fourth grade. Some of these kids look older than fourth grade, I don't know why. But you're in fourth, some of them don't, but you're in fourth grade, okay? And the room is shaking. What's that mean, the room is shaking? There's speakers around, and the speakers are rumbling, okay? So there's a simulated earthquake going on in the classroom, okay? And it can happen at any time. It's fourth grade, so you're not moving around from classroom to classroom. You're in one classroom. The room is shaking. What happens? Okay, everybody goes to their seismograph. There are three of them in the room, okay? And they look at the at the graphs, and they start computing. You know, computing how far away is it from this seismograph? Okay, and they get strings. Okay, and they up at the top, they have strings, and from the three seismographs in the room, you know, they stretch their strings out and they walk around and they find the place where the earthquake is, the roomquake is. Okay? Now, the reason they can do that so quickly, okay, oh, and then they mark it on the ceiling. Okay? And they look up at the ceiling and they say, oh my God, you know, we've had four of these and they, like three of them seem to be on the same line with each other. What's going on there? Okay, the reason that they can get started doing this so quickly and they know what to do with their seismographs and their strings and whatever it is because these roomquakes come anytime. I mean, they can come overnight. They don't come during spelling tests. They don't come during tests. The teacher can arrange that. They can come during lunch or recess. They can come while the kids are, you know, in the room. Okay, and, you know, all of a sudden happens. So they might walk in the morning and see that, you know, they got all this stuff on the seismographs. And so they've done it before. They're starting to get really good, right, at doing this little exercise. But this little exercise, you know, of how far away is it, and let's measure to find the epicenter, well, you know, that's like the easy stuff, right? That's the easy stuff. But this thing about, oh my God, three of them seem to be in a line with each other. What's going on? Oh, that's the really interesting stuff, right? And they're set up to do that. Okay, so now, when are the lectures? When are there, you know, when do they do reading? What, you know, what happens next when they see them in a line with each other, right? So, so when they first get started and the first one happens, you know, the teacher gathers them together and there's some discussion about, somebody says it's like an earthquake, because if you have 20 kids or 30 kids or 40 kids or whatever it is in the class, somebody's going to say it's like an earthquake, okay? Somebody's going to say it without fail, okay? And, you know, the teacher says, well, what do you know about earthquakes? And they know very little about earthquakes, but they're in Chicago, these particular kids, so they have not experienced earthquakes. But the teacher tells them a little bit, okay? And they wonder a little bit, and they put up on the board the things they think they know, and they, you know, and then the teacher says, well, you know, scientists have this way that they can go about figuring out where the earthquake actually is, okay? And the kids say, oh, wow, yeah, how do they do that, okay? And there's a chance for a little lecture, right? And a little bit of learning of reading graphs and a little bit of math and a little, you know, all kinds of stuff that come up there. So so this is Roomquake. You see a lot of different technology there. You know, some of it's strings. But this one all the way on the right is, I'm not sure what it is. I think it's a, you know what, I don't know what it is. I used to know and I forgot. There's also some other technology in the room. There's some large screens that are set up that show data as it's collected. So as the kids are are analyzing the different graphs, you know, and coming up with some solutions there. The data goes up there, so everybody can see and everybody can share. Here's another one. This is, what did I tell you, 10th graders, CI Spy. And this is history. This is an AR, augmented reality implementation, around a important civil rights, I don't want to call it monument, place, okay, in this particular community in Virginia. This one's in Virginia. And this school where integration happened, you know, over a lot of people's dead bodies, okay, where people of kids of different races, different backgrounds, got to know each other, okay, where school dances looked different, you know, over a period of, well, immediately, right, but looked different over a period of years. Where there were important civil rights leaders who came to town, and who came to town, where there were things happening in other places that got reacted to in this community, okay? And through augmented reality, the kids can visit all of these different things that were happening over time. Now, it wouldn't be, you know, it would simply be a museum experience if they were going through and experiencing all that, just walking through and, you know, putting their iPad up and saying, okay, show me what it looked like in here in 1964. Okay, now show me what it looked like in 1967. You know, I mean, if they just walked through and did that, it wouldn't be all that, it would be nice technology, but it wouldn't be all that interesting. But this particular AR implementation is actually built for doing inquiry history, okay? And what that means is that the kids spend some time in the classroom learning about the civil rights movement, and I don't know how they learn about it and what they do in there, but they spend some time in the classroom learning about it, okay? And they generate questions, things that they want to know more about, that they want to answer. And then they go in over to this, they go over to this local place, okay, old school building, and they take the AR, they take the iPads with them, okay, and they use this AR capability to explore the place the way that historians would explore the place, to collect data and to answer their questions, okay, so they get to kind of take x-ray views of rooms. What did it look like then? They can, they do time travel. That's one of the really big things that they do in here is time travel. So they can set a year when they want to, or I don't know how, they can set a year when they want to see things happening, and they can watch what's happening there. They have access to different civil rights leaders you see at the bottom. They also have they've got so, you know, the equivalent of a field guide where they can look at some things along the way, resources. They also have a context aware note taking tool. So anytime they want to take notes, they can take notes on their iPad, and the system knows, okay, what year and place, you know, they are focusing on at that moment when they take the notes. Okay, I like to imagine that when they get back to class, okay, there's a virtual school building, okay, and they can walk through it the same way and find their notes attached to time and place. But I don't know that it ever got implemented that far. Okay, so there we have technology actually putting them in the middle of the goings-on when schools were getting desegregated. Okay, and being historians, you know, and learning some things about it, you could even imagine them being anthropologists. It doesn't have to be historians. Okay. I went the wrong way. And here's the last one of these that I'm going to show you. I got many more little things that I'm going to show you. And this is EcoMove, done by that other ed school at Harvard that I understand you guys don't talk to each other too much. But
she was here.
Tina was here?
To give a talk about
yeah.
this.
Yeah. And I love Tina and her ideas. She's great. So this is EcoMove. And EcoMove is a virtual world. And it's a virtual, it's so, did she talk about EcoMove or did she talk about something else? Okay, so you know. Okay, so I won't say a lot about it, but in EcoMove, the kids are trying to, they're wandering around this virtual pond, okay? And they're trying to figure out why is it that the fish died off, the big fish died off. And they have all kinds of stuff available to them. They have field guides, they have data collection tools, charts, record-keeping tools, a calendar for doing time travel. And the thing that they love the best, I guess Tina told you, is that they have this submarine, and they can go into the water in the submarine, and it kind of is like the magic school bus. It goes, and they go in, and they can look at the underwater world at lots of different levels of magnification. Okay, so they walk around in this world. They walk underwater. They have superpowers. Okay, they examine this world and get to do a lot of the same things that scientists do in this world. And I just watched two classrooms of kids working with EcoMove. So Tina, of course, is biased, so she'll tell you everybody loves it. But I'd have to tell you that everybody loves it. And they get in, and we interviewed the kids 2 weeks after they had done the EcoMove, after they finished the EcoMove unit. And after 2 weeks of working in EcoMove, these kids were ready to be scientists interacting with us as scientists. I mean, that was just amazing to me, okay? That small amount of time that they were in this world and that they had autonomy to move around in the world and they had all these different ways of navigating the world. And one of the things I'm finding out is that these guys have no idea what good designers they are, because you know, they used their intuitions and they designed this thing very nicely, and of course they did a lot of iterative design and made it better and better. But I think that part of what they don't know about it, that what they did, is that because of the way it's designed, you've got kids who have lots of different identities, lots of different dispositions, who find that they feel that they belong in this world, that it's just for them. Okay, so you have the kids, some of the kids actually come in feeling like scientists. There's one girl in the class who, she's really worried about pollution in the ocean. I think she means all the plastic in the ocean, but, you know, pollution in the ocean. And this was, you know, she got to do some investigations around water, and that was really, really quite exciting for her. But on the other end of the spectrum, you have the kid who doesn't like school. He's known as, you know, not paying attention ever, and he's really not involved most of the time that they're working on this. His partner's doing most of the work. And yet, 2 weeks later, when he, you know, as after he's had a chance to realize, to think about this experience that he had, he's telling us all about how he goes, how amazed he is, first of all, that people doing some little thing like putting fertilizer down can have such a big impact on the environment around them. And he's like, this is like a kid speaking from awe, okay? And then he tells us about how he regularly goes fishing, and, you know, and he talks about the water that comes out with the fish, and they put the fish down in this place, so, you know, to leave them till they're ready to go cook them, I guess, take them home. And he talks about the water in there and the water in the ocean and all this stuff that's in there, and he had no idea that there was all this stuff, and he's going to start looking at it differently now. So there was a way in for him also, okay? And then there's a way in for the kids who read mystery books, right? And a way in for the kids who love to be problem solvers, okay? They all have a way into it, and they all come out kind of like, you know, I would say changed people. right? Just from that little bit of immersion in that world, it feels very real to them. I don't think I have time to tell you about this one, so I'm not going to tell you a lot about it. This is happening. It is a project happening in Maine, in schools that are, they have two-room school, a lot of rural two-room schools there. So a lot of the education that they do is education of kids from a lot of grades all working together. And they are working with the fishermen. They're trying to help the fishermen, they're trying to make science real by having the fishermen bring their issues in to the kids, okay? And then actually the scientists want to learn some science behind these, you know, practices that they've been carrying out as fishermen all this time. Why do they do it that way? And they've got the kids and the scientists working together. And they've got so they've got this real world set of issues that the fishermen are experiencing and that they need to, they're trying to answer questions about. And the technology helps them talk to the fishermen, but it also supports idea posting, question posting, expert finding, data collection, data sharing, discussion, presentation, argument making, all kinds of stuff. Okay, so in all of these, the learners were immersed in role play. So you saw role play for the purpose of addressing some mission or challenge that's connected to the world. The technology integrates a whole variety of different functions, allowing them to play roles as professionals as they're addressing these challenges. They have support they need for both project and learning success, with scaffolding coming from a combination of teacher, technology, and peers. I didn't tell you anything about technology, but just imagine it. The kids are there for each other, so that's what peers mean. And class time is spent playing two things, playing their roles to achieve goals and making sense together. What does this all mean? And the activities afford learning disciplinary content and practices, as well as project, problem-solving, communication, collaboration projects, practices. And, you know, the kids do identity work, and they build their confidence. I mean, I just told you a couple stories about identity work, and they experience the joy. They experience the joy of being scientists. Okay? So I like these projects. I love these projects, because they all support the kind of sustained engagement that's needed for deep and lasting learning. And this is what I'm going to, the only slide that tells you anything about how people learn. So there may be one more, okay? So it turns out, you know, in all these examples, you're seeing examples of how the activities the kids are doing, the challenge, plus the way the world is set up for them, is promoting and sustaining active engagement. Okay, over long periods of time. In fact, the shortest one of these is the EcoMove one, which is only 2 weeks. The other ones are way longer than that. Okay, and I tell people that, you know, promoting and sustaining active engagement is somewhere between 50% and 80% of promoting learning. I made up those numbers, but they're not bad numbers. Okay, they're big. I mean, it's a really big part of it. Okay, and that's because developing deep understanding and developing masterful capabilities happen incrementally, and they take time, long-term, sustained effort. Okay, you gotta promote engagement for that to happen. Okay, but missing in all of my descriptions of this, I told you all about the joy the kids have. But I didn't tell you about the concrete ways that they actually support learning. I told you about the activities, but I didn't tell you about the sense-making itself, how they make sense. So, okay, so this one says things about how people learn, too. So I already said the first one, developing deep understanding, masterful capabilities is incremental and takes sustained and long-term effort. Learning requires repeated and varied practice, engaging in those, say, learning practices requires repeated and varied practice, engaging in those practices, using those skills, and reflecting on it. They got to do it over and over again. Okay, so right now in school, doing it over and over again means give somebody a worksheet and have them do it over and over again. You don't get a whole lot out of that, okay? I mean, kids learn how to do addition that way. That's nice. But you don't learn scientific practices that way. You learn them by practicing them in context of where they're needed. Okay, so these kids who are doing the room quakes, they're making sense of these earthquakes over and over again, and their wonder and their awe, right? And they're questioning, you know, every time they have another earthquake and they see where these earthquakes are and how they're dispersed around the classroom, okay, they're asking other questions and they're asking to dig deeper, okay, into plate tectonics, right? So they repeat it in varied practice. You gotta have a reason for them to have that. Deep understanding requires reflection on what can be learned from experience, connection to what is already known, and lots of incremental revisiting, reconnecting, and refining. So you have to use that stuff you're learning over and over and over again to refine it, okay? To really learn it, to connect it to other things you know, okay? Then there's this thing that happens when we're learning. You know, some things we want to learn or want others to learn are counterintuitive or otherwise difficult to grok. And I use the word grok on purpose there. Does everybody know grok? Well, think about grok meaning the deepest understanding of something you can get to, okay? So it comes from Strange in a Strange Land from Robert Heinlein. So some things are just difficult. Some things are just difficult or counterintuitive. So technology can make some of that easier, and that's another role, you know, another set of roles for technology. So there are a bunch of technologies you know about. I'm not going to show you these. Okay, so intelligent tutoring systems can personalize learning of disciplinary skills. Simulation software allows asking what if, trying things out. What if we do this? What if we do this? Modeling software allows imagining, critiquing, debugging complex structures and processes. Okay, scaffolding can be embedded in other technology being used, and collaboration tools support discussion. So these are all kinds of, you know, these are all technologies that have been around for a while. Modeling technologies have been around for scientists for a while. They've sort of been around for kids, but they haven't been real easy to use. There are people who are starting to make them easier for kids to use. But there's this whole other set of technologies for helping with sense making that I like to say kind of integrate sense making with expression, okay? So you're familiar with, and those are the ones I'm going to show you. So you're familiar with modeling to make sense, okay? So you're trying to understand something. How's that process work? How could all these pieces fit together? And you start putting things together in 3D, or you're putting things together on the computer, or sketching something out, and it just helps you to think about it, okay? That modeling and that sketching are expression. But there are several of these that I want to show you. Acting it out, that's the bees and the molecules I'm going to show you. Collaborative sketching, collaborative argumentation, and helping kids really be able to do modeling, so by expressing themselves to what they understand already to do it. I want to show you some examples of technology making that easy. So here we have acting it out, and this is the bees. Okay, so you see on the left, okay, some examples of kids holding bee puppets. Okay, now these bee puppets, and you see that this bee puppet, the one down at the bottom, you see that they're very beautiful. Okay, I mean, they have this puppet maker who's been making them for them. I imagine that if they ever get sold, they won't be quite as beautiful. But they're really beautiful right now. The important thing about the bee puppet is that it's got in it technology that makes it context aware, okay? So that it traces, the kids run around the room with the bee and the computer knows where the bee has been, okay? And it has displays. Those are displays for the hive. But it has a display, you know, that shows how much nectar is in the bee, okay? And when the bee goes to the flower and takes nectar from it, the amount of nectar goes up. And when the bee goes to the hive, that That's the hive over on that side. When the bee goes to the hive is also beautiful, by the way. When the bee goes to the hive and drops off the nectar, then it goes down. The hive also has a display in it, and as it fills with nectar, the display shows that it's being filled with nectar. There are also flowers, okay, and some of the flowers have nectar in them and some of them don't. The flowers do not have displays, though I just heard yesterday on the radio about something about how bees know when flowers, they can feel when flowers have nectar in them or not, something about the whether they have an ion in them or they don't have an ion, so they feel the electricity or they don't feel the electricity. I just heard that yesterday on the radio. so they could in the next version of this do something where the bees could feel it. But in any case, the flowers have sensors, okay, and they know if they have nectar in them or if they don't have nectar in them. So what happens? So you have a set of kids in the class who are bees, and you have a set of the kids in the class who are watching them, and the bees go around and they collect nectar and they bring it to the hive, and then some smart aleck in the class who's watching says, but you know, or somebody who's doing it, who's acting as a bee, says, but you know, bees tend to follow each other in the real world, and how can they follow each other? Right? And just because somebody said that, they get to discuss the bee dance or bee communication. They get to discuss bees. Well, you know, what would it mean if you were a bee? What would it mean to communicate? And what would be the kinds of things, this is first graders, by the way, and what would be the kinds of things, or second graders, I don't know, they look a little old for first grade, what would be the kind of things that, you know, that you'd want to communicate? And they come up with ways of communicating, okay, and they do the bee thing again, and everybody gets a chance to do it, and everybody gets a chance to watch, and then they do the bee thing again, and they collect the nectar, okay, and yeah, that communication worked better. And then the kids really want to know, well, how do bees really do it, right? And they learn about the bee dance, okay. Here's kids being molecules. So you can see that on the right they're a solid, and on the left they're I don't know if they're a liquid or a gas, but I think they're gas on the left. And that they see on the display in front of them, they see themselves as molecules, okay, and they see how close they are to each other. And in the version of this that came after I got these pictures, they also see the bonds between the molecules. Okay? So then as they move away from each other, and you know, you could have one kid who's in that group of six going like that, right? And follow those bonds, they're getting weaker. Okay? Oh, wait a minute. Is that what happens when we move farther from each other? And they move farther from each other, and you know, they see things happen, they run around the room, you see them doing it that way, and there, you know, there are no bonds between them. That's gas. So they're acting it out. Okay, I don't need to tell you more than that. I guess what I should tell you about it is that the way that this works is that it uses the cameras that are in a Wii, and or that are in the, that communicate with the Wii. So it uses the cameras that communicate with the Wii, and I think there are three of them around the classroom, at three of those cameras, and they can track six or seven kids at a time, last time I knew. So again, you can have six or seven kids doing it, and you can have everybody else watching, and you can give everybody a chance. It's, you know, you have three or four groups, and kids will stay engaged with that. It's okay. I'm not going to show you the collaborative sketching, because you can imagine collaborative sketching, but what you can get on the computer if you're doing collaborative sketching, and it's not just a piece of paper, right, is that you can have the computer be moving things, be keeping layers, right, and moving layers back and forth. You can have the computer measure angles. You can, you know, there's all kinds of stuff the computer can do. You can circle something and you can move it over someplace else, right? I can give you copies of this if you want to look at what these guys are doing with collaborative sketching. This is real interesting. This is a artificial intelligence project, and it's collaborative argumentation. So what's happening is that the computer and peers and the teacher are helping each other make arguments, and in this case it happens to be scientific arguments. They do scientific arguments and they do legal arguments, and they've done college and they've done high school. I don't know if they've gotten to middle school for the science. It's really good for any kind of genre writing. So an argument does genre writing, okay? And the computer can do some analysis and can provide some feedback, but it can't analyze the content of it. It can analyze the structure, and then peers can analyze the content and give each other some feedback. And a lot of that can happen. You know, there's a lot of learning that happens by looking at what other people write, what other people are doing, and not just at your own. This is the last one that I want to show you. And this is called SimSam. It was actually done in town here, too, at Tufts. And modeling is hard, right? And it turns out that for kids, this is middle school kids, for kids, a lot of times making the connections between the scientific phenomena they're seeing, and especially stuff that's invisible, you know, and what they're learning about because it's invisible, is really difficult. So what they do is they get the kids to try to imagine those things that are invisible, like water vapor as a puddle is evaporating, you know, and suppose it were visible, what would it look like, right? And they have the kids draw pictures of it and then use those pictures, the pieces of the pictures, and stop frame animation to create what they think feels like an animation of it, okay? And then they move those animations to the modeling tool, okay? And in the modeling tool, they can make connections between things happening in their animation, the things in the animation. They can actually say what they think the relationships are. And then there's a modeling program that can take those relationships that they put in and run a model for them, okay? And they can do this back and forth of, oh, gee, that's not what I meant it to look like, okay? And incrementally move towards having a nice, a better understanding of those phenomena that are invisible, so hard to imagine. So it's really, it's really trying to make that abstract very concrete for the kids. And to do it in a way that the kids are used to doing things. They're used to drawing pictures. They're used to making dioramas. They're used to doing that, to having those kinds of representations. So they start from there. Okay. So the first set illustrated what those, you know, whole units might look like. Okay. I said a lot of this. Lectures de-emphasized, challenges and missions emphasized, activities in the context of challenges, lectures I already said, reading. Learners have a lot more agency at a level, a lot of agency, at a level they can handle and with the scaffolding they require. But none of those that I showed you were whole technologically. Okay, they were technology rich, every one of them, but they were not technologically complete. And the other thing is that they weren't connected to each other. Okay, I showed you one fourth grade science thing and one 10th grade history and one 7th grade science and real learning. If you really want kids to learn science and appreciate scientists and appreciate the nature of science and what scientists do, you need to have a lot of years of those things. And they have to be coherent with each other. They have to be, you know, voiced in ways that are coherent. They've got to be repeatedly doing the same practices across all the different activities that they're doing. Also, none of them integrate assessment in ways that are needed, but I'm not going to talk about that. So they're wholes, but they're not whole, okay? The second set were really nifty, useful technologies to help learners get to understanding. And there was one more I wanted to add that I just was reminded about last night, and then I didn't have a chance to add it. And that was one that helps first, second, and third graders to do arithmetic and really understand what multiplication is and how to, maybe it's fourth and fifth graders too, and how to do and what it means to do some really sophisticated multiplication. And they have all kinds of timelines and arrays and all kinds of stuff that kids can use as representations and online crayons and whatever that they can use to really make sense of what they're doing with the arithmetic. So I meant to give you a discipline, that discipline specific one, and I didn't do it. Though the bees and the molecules were discipline specific. Okay, so the second set were nifty useful technologies to help learners get to understanding. So each promotes learning in ways that would not be possible without the computer, but each one's just a piece. Okay. So what if we're going to get pragmatic? Okay. I already said this. Individual units that work well to foster learning are too fragmented for coherence. Okay. Fragmented in lots of different ways. If every different unit that's out there uses different technology, then you can bet that nothing's going to get used. Okay. If every different unit has different conventions, then you can bet nothing's going to get used. Okay. You may or may not be able to cobble them together for coverage, but again, if they're so different in respect to style, if they're real different with respect to technologies, it's just not going to happen, even if you can cobble them together. So I think, you know, just, okay. I think that what our challenge is, okay, in moving forward, and remember I said that I thought, my claim was technology can do all these nifty things, okay? I showed you that. My second claim was that we can put together real curriculum that's coherent across years right now, okay? So the question, and it only takes will and resources and imagination, okay? So what's needed now, I think, are two things, okay? First of all, we got to take all that, those really nice ideas that everybody has about bringing the field into the classroom, you know, about bringing people out to the field, right? Those were the examples I gave you, you know, and all those other things. We've got to be creating curriculum that coheres between and across grades, between and across disciplines, topical areas, scientific practices and other practices, the technology that's used, and maybe more than that. The other thing that I did that once, and I'm gonna just sort of show you. Not with technology. I didn't, no integration technology. But the other challenge that we have is to create a technological infrastructure, technology infrastructure, that integrates commonly used technological functions so that it's not a teacher saying, okay, I'll take this argumentation tool here, but you know, you'll use some other tool to do collaboration with each other, or no, you won't do collaboration at all because I just can't deal with two tools at the same time, okay? But a technology infrastructure that integrates commonly used functions, okay, in a way that's usable, some of it across disciplines, but some of it within disciplines, some of it across ages, but some of it you want to do it a little differently for elementary school than middle school than high school, okay? It has to be able to easily accommodate new functions. It has to be adaptable for disciplinary needs. Oh, shoot. and functions as a, I don't know what, okay? But basically, it has to be integrated with curriculum as well. So there are a couple coherent across years curricula that have qualities like the ones I just talked about. My own is project-based inquiry science, and I could show you a little bit of that. It's 3 years of middle school science. It's project-driven. There's very little technology. But the conventions are the same all the way through. And what do I mean about the conventions? Moving from whole class to small group to individual to small group to whole class, you know, kinds of of activities. Okay, there's convention, kind of convention. Another is that kids make certain kinds of presentations to each other. They share at a variety of different times, and that's and that happens similarly across units. Every unit begins with a big challenge or a big question, okay, and begins with getting them, you know, getting them drawn in to that big challenge or that big question. You know, every they're sometimes designing and running experiments, sometimes just running experiments, sometimes doing modeling, sometimes using simulations. There's time for doing and there's time for reflection and learning about the practices, that, you know, really thinking about the practices they're carrying out. So that's what I mean about conventions. Project-based inquiry science is mine. IQuest, it's middle school science. IQuest is another middle school science a curriculum that's 3 years long. It actually has some of the same authors, but I do talk about that one being mine. Joe Krajcik and Brian Reiser and Danny Edelson are, I think, authors on both of them. So there are a couple of those. There are a couple of these student scientist platforms that aim to pull together that variety of functions. One's called Inquiry Space, and it brings together a lot of inquiry functions. Exploring with data, gathering sensor data, making explanations, collaboration. It's got a lot of those things built in. And they've used it so far for physics, and they've got a new project where they're taking it and saying, okay, what would it mean to use the same platform for biology and for chemistry? And I guess it, if I said biology and chemistry, then it's probably at the high school level. iSense is, these are both local. iSense is at, for middle school and high school, and it just pulls together a lot of different data manipulation and making sense of data and collection and collections of data together with each other. All of this suggests, okay, the stuff that's there, okay, suggests that there's a lot that we know how to do. It doesn't have to be perfect to make it work and be really good for school, right? And there are some schools that are ready to do this kind of thing. Not all of them, okay? I would never want to push it on at this point, push it on any school. But there's schools that are ready. You could make demonstration projects. And we could have a big impact. I mean, I know you guys have some technology that could, you know, and some units that you've written that could become part of this. So I'm reaching out and saying to everybody, we need to make this a goal, that we're going to make this big thing happen. I guess what I have to say is that there's some adaptability that we need to learn about, but we know how to do, you know, most of the rest of it. We need to have imagination. We need to have will. And I think I'll leave it at that. Yeah, no.
So, and I know you said we don't have to fix everybody and everything, but there are places that are ready to do this. Do you have thoughts on, like, good strategies for reaching out to schools to...
We need other people. You know, I came up here, I told you, I came up here wanting to, like, make this a couple big demonstration projects happen. And I learned that I don't know how to find the people and the resources and whatever to do it. So I think, you know, what we need is to find the people who have imagination about those kinds of things. I have imagination about what the you know, about what the integration of everything could look like and what school could look like. And I have, you know lots of people I can bring together to make it happen. But the rest of it, I just don't know how to do. So, yeah, we have to figure that out. Yeah.
Yeah, I like the idea to get away from those fragmented
projects,
like two weeks and then maybe one, 2 years from now.
Yeah, but it doesn't work.
So I was wondering about what the strategic research site is for doing that. And it doesn't seem to be science at all. I mean,
What do you mean?
And I where to start implementing that comprehensive model. And in my view, it's always good to start with the low-hanging fruits.
So what do you think is low-hanging?
And to kind of start with existing structures. And the most low-hanging fruit is mathematics, because mathematics is taught through all the years. It has a comprehensive structure.
Oh,
it is there. So
the thing about mathematics is that you'd have to change the whole 12 years at once to make it work. I don't know. Or you'd have to get buy-in at the whole 12 years to do it, right? It's something you'd want to... I don't know if we know how to do math.
Yeah, but
I don't know if we know how to do math. I know we know how to do science, and I know we know how to do history. Okay, not because there's been a lot of research in history, but because if history is about inquiry, then we know how to do history.
Yeah, but if you knew how to do math, you would have the whole structure. Because this ties everything together, and you could use it through the whole. Then you have the comprehensive.
Yeah, maybe so. I mean, to me, the low-hanging fruit is middle school science. Okay, because I know middle school science. So to me, you know, and I think middle school social studies is also low-hanging fruit. Because middle school, you know, you're not worrying about college yet, you know? I mean, and the kids are going to be with you in middle school, right? I mean, the kids just eat this stuff up. So I don't know. I have to think about math. I was a math major. I know math, but I don't know it in terms of research.
You have I really enjoyed your talk. It's great. It makes me think about this whole idea of balancing routines and repertoire.
Uh-huh.
Because if you have a routine, the kids are familiar and they're building on what they have, and you know, when the earthquake happens, they know what to do. And repertoire is when you add things, tools to your toolkit. Of course, you need to do that in order to actually learn something. You can't just do the same thing over.
Right.
So the question is, where are the routines of K-12 that are in place that could be built on to easily slide more technology in and learn? Are these programming clubs out there that people are doing? Is there people using Excel spreadsheets in classroom? Are there places where technology is already in place that is
sure, you can get Excel in there, you know, when you're doing data, you know, when you're doing data exploration, manipulation, whatever. But I think, you don't get so much bang for the buck from that, right? You get bang for the buck from, you know, the things that are going to really to move the kids towards being willing learners, right? Not just willing learners, but passionate learners, right? So I don't know. I mean, I call that kind of stuff you're talking about tweaking around the edges, and there's nothing wrong with it. It's just that for me, there's not enough bang to the buck to really make it worthwhile, you know, my putting my energy into it. So, yeah, so here's my thought about it, okay? My thought is that it's going to take 10, 15 years, okay? Maybe 20, 30 years. I talk about 40 years in the desert, okay? So I don't know how long it's going to take, but let's say it's going to take a generation, whatever generation is. Okay, so how do you get started? Right? And I think that there are places that are ready. So for example, there are places that are using this middle school science curriculum that I'm the lead author on. It's had more than 1 million student years. So that's significant. You know, there are places where it's happening. So I think that, you know, that those classrooms are, we want to talk low-hanging fruit. Those classrooms already are using pedagogy, you know, that gets kids excited. You could do even better if you redid project-based inquiry science as, you know, I don't know if you start over or if you start with it as a, you know, as a basis. If you redo it, you know, with just making the challenges so much more exciting, like technology can do, and then integrating the technology. And I think that when we don't have to move from paper to book to this to that to the other thing, that, you know, when you can just go back and forth like this to see things, that there's so much more that you can do, you know, and it's, and you don't have to worry so much about coverage anymore, right? Because you can cover the stuff that somebody tells you to cover. I mean, you don't politically have to worry about coverage so much anymore. You cover the stuff they tell you to cover, and you do get to do all this other stuff too, because the technology just makes everything flow so well. So that's one place I would start. Another place is that there are schools that are calling themselves project-based schools. I'm a little leery about them because they all feel like they know what they're doing. They're kind of arrogant about it. So, you know, so I don't know that the ideas of scientists can get in. But there are other places where there are places where they're more humble and they want to make things happen. And I, you know, my idea is to find those places and use those as demonstration sites. And that the way you make things happen, make it happen so that in 20 years, it won't be my grandkids in 20 years, it will be my great-grandchildren. But so, they won't be in 20 years, they'll be, you know, be farther along than that. But then I think you make sure that people are seeing those demonstrations. And I think the demonstrations need to be small enough so that people can imagine it happening in their backyard too. Right? If the demonstration is too big and overwhelming, like it's we changed the whole school, people aren't going to feel they're not going to feel warm about it, right? They gotta in order for it to spread, people have to feel like they can handle it. So, I hope that answered. And those are just my ideas about it. I don't know. Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't that the great challenge?
That's the great challenge.
The great challenge is you want implementing it to make it helpful for facilitators. But if you want a systematic 12-year-long implementation, no one's going to buy that because it's too big.
Well, that's why I think that you need to do the smaller pieces, and so people will start having more imagination, and then too big, you know, they'll move in their zone of proximal zone. What?
How do you sell the coherence after for 12 years?
Well, so suppose you have coherence for 3 years. I mean, I think that the demonstrations have to be of a lot of different kinds of coherence. Okay, so you might have 3 years of middle school science. Okay, you may have inquiry in history and in science in middle school. You may have genetics over the curriculum, right? Or evolution over the curriculum, right? Or plate tecton, I don't know. Earth science over the, I don't know. Over the 12 years. You might have something that's, you know, out of school activities and in school activities that connect to each other over 1 year, Right, so I think that the chunks have to be a variety of sizes. So everybody, chunks have to be a variety of sizes. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. I mean, this is my best thought about it. And the truth is, like I said, I didn't know how to raise money for it. I don't know how to find people to be partners if I don't have money. I don't, you know, so I don't know. At this point, I feel stymied. I still feel excited, but I don't know how to do it. I don't know who to do it with. You know, I don't have a good business person to work with. I don't have that kind of imagination or marketing person. Okay, well, if anybody wants to, you know, be a business person or marketing person or scientist with me. Yeah.
That's sort of a question, maybe I'm sorry, but middle school science teachers, train them more technology savvy.
Yeah. I mean, that's one of the big issues too. Is teacher education and teacher professional development? Yeah. I mean, it's got to be part of the package, the demonstration package. Yeah, it's got to be part of the demonstration package. You know, I think that technology's hard because really hard because there's not enough support in schools for it. Okay. So maybe part of the demonstration packages that, you know, some of the money that gets raised is for technology people in those demonstration schools so that the people can actually carry it out, right? But without the technology, I mean, getting the pedagogy in place, without the technology, which is what we've done with PBIS, you know, the real key is the teachers buying in and being excited about it, because if the first time they do it, they don't, you know, they don't realize all the affordances of the curriculum and they don't make it work so that the kids learn all the science that they could learn or all the practices they could learn. The kids are still going to be doing better than they and be more excited and have learned more than they do in their regular classes. So and the teachers can grow into it. But the technology is harder. I mean, I think that the demonstration, the money that goes with demonstration projects will have to pay for that.
Well, everyone's invited to have some pizza, and we can continue the conversation mm-hmm. around the table, but thank you very much.
My pleasure. Great. Great questions. Thank you.
I just realized my book was short.
Oh, no. I don't think so.
Over lunch, I want to ask you more what you think the appropriate embedded assessment is.
Yeah, I mean, we tried one or the other.
Oh, this one was the one that came from there.
This one came from there.
Oh, okay.
That just seems crazy to me.
Yeah, why are we doing that? No, that one's just, that one's dead.
Yeah, I really apologize. I don't think I've never had this issue before. I don't know.